Hi guys. Well, my apologies if I seem a little slow and a bit muddle-headed, but I've had to do a chore this evening which has taken a few hours. And boy, am I glad to be back home with a cup of tea. Cheers. Oh. Well, I don't really know what I'm going to call this video yet, but me being me, it'll probably be something a little cryptic. So if you're expecting this to be about the Raspberry Pi computer, sorry, it's not about that. If you're also one of the people who follows this channel for the occasional food video, sorry, it's not about that either. It's about a retro game which was released in the early 80s, and I didn't really understand until now, pretty much, or within recent years. It was released when I was but a tiny tiddler young teenager, I suppose. And it was a game which actually had very, very real world consequences. Good consequences for the people who actually got it all right. I am talking, of course, about Pi-mania. The Pi-man. Now, I'm going to put a few links in the hoo-ha bar, but through my reworking of various bits and pieces and educating myself about the past, I found out about the future. Well, the recent past. That's not quite as past as the old past, which is the retro past. In other words, the game was made in the early 80s, and this wasn't made until the early 2000s, or the late 2000s-ish. It is Pi-mania, the music of Mel Croucher and Automata UK Limited, and it features that incredible character there, the Pi-man. In fact, this album is actually a long piece of artwork, which actually folds out like that. And that's the whole cover. And there you've got various bits and pieces and people, including Croucher, etc. And even Sir Clive Sinclair being dripped on with baked beans by the Pie Man. And various articles and artifacts which actually formed part of the game. Inside we have a bit of a poster, which I'll go through in a bit more detail. And as you can see, this is from Feeding Tube Limited. They are an American place which manufactures, low print numbers of albums, vinyl. Oh, pardon me, I really am feeling it this evening. There's a couple of little cartoons in there. The Pie Man needs you. You'll probably find them somewhere else, because I'll include a few links to a few of these bits and pieces. So you will get to see these probably in other documents, larger, if you absolutely have to, if you know what I mean. Inside is a poster. Whoops. There's the sun, and I think that's, is that the Pie Man? Yeah, the Pie Man again, with some of the odd bits and pieces. I think this is part of the game cover that was made on the cassette. And then you have a lot of the history, some of our cartoons, and of course, the solution. And I think the PDF that I'm going to point you to, or at least one of the PDFs, should have a larger version of that. The sleeve of the record is, a cut-out Pi-Man face, if you actually wanted to destroy the sleeve. And yet another cartoon, and, track listing, etc., etc. And that's the base of the Pi-Man's nose from that. This was released in a limited edition of 500. And after listening to it, I think that any modern pair of ears would probably conclude that it should have been slightly more limited. That was a bit of a funny, because the history of this is a little on the serious side. Now, the game itself, if you broke the code, you couldn't get at the solution. The key of playing the game was actually to get all the clues, which was pretty much part of the process of playing the game. The clues in the game would eventually lead you to be at a particular location at a particular time. Croucher and the Pie Man would be at that location every year until the prize of the Golden Sundial of Pie was won. Turned out to be a serious prize, worth at the time £6,000, which is a serious sum of money. Where is the Golden Sundial of Pie now? I haven't got a clue, but two women won it. Let's have a look. Pie Mania. It's going to go, the first link will go to the a relatively short Wikipedia about the game. And link number two will take you to the Wikipedia page of Mel Croucher. He released quite a few video games, and he worked with there's a load of names around here. I've forgotten who his name is. It's linked here, but he actually played the Pie Man in some sort of... Yeah, he was dressed up as a Pie Man in photographs. It's all in there somewhere. And I think I'll get on with the Pie Man before I move on. Third link is going to be a link to that record, which I just showed you. Fourth link is to the PDF, which is the press kit, which contains the insides, and you should be able to expand that up to see the various bits and pieces if you wish. Link number five will take you to a much more serious page. In fact, no, I'll readjust that. Link number five will take you to the answer of Pie Mania, the answer of the various bits and pieces that are in the game. Right. The first link in the second section is to a blog called The Digital Antiquarian. And it's the Merry Pranksters of Automata. And Christian Penfold, he was the one who acted with Croucher. Now, they released Pie Mania, did that, and then after the success of that, they started working on Deus Ex Machinima. That was a game which, it was more than a game, it was an experience. What it consisted of was a soundtrack, which actually contained stars like John Pertwee, who was... not long left as the Doctor in Doctor Who, Frankie Howard, Ian Drury, and I've forgotten the name of one of the women who was singing some of the main parts. It's all in the wiki. But it was at a time in the 80s when home computers started to really ramp up, and rather than be as they started, which was the sort of mail order things, and the things were pretty much all done by post mail. what we know now as communities of people who communicate very quickly by bulletin boards and bulletin boards, what am I talking about? Forums were previously knit together by magazines like Bat Pug and other things like that, and word of mouth. And people would send off for solder kits for home computers and put them together themselves. But a shift was happening. Everything was starting to commercialize. You could then, at that time, start to see home computers in the major department stores. And that meant that all the games had to compete for shelf space. So, whereas Croucher was, and Penfold, I think, were quite fun characters. Eccentric, I think, wouldn't be too far off a way to describe them. However, in this new world, they had to get through the buyers for these chain stores in order to get the games on the shelves, and they couldn't do that with Deus Ex Machinima. Quite a bit of money had been invested in it, as you can probably gather by the stars. And the net result was Croucher basically became quite a bit crouchy. He let off at the industry for basically ruining the fun, ruining that individual entrepreneurship of computing and turning it instead into a more bland consumerist experience. Of course, other titles that were considered more mainstream, like Ultimate Play of the Game and etc., etc., you know, they pretty much ruled the roost. They ruled the shelves in the stores because people thought they could make big money from them. Things which encompassed British eccentricity at its best, you know, and went outside into the world of art. That all fell by the wayside. What exactly that was responsible for, and how British computing could have been different had that not happened and stayed as the sort of hobbyist era that it was, I don't know. I don't think anyone can really hazard a strong guess at what it could have been. There's the argument that if it wasn't for the commercialization aspect of the games and the systems in that time, then maybe it wouldn't have had the growth that it did enjoy in the end. So that one is a very interesting one to read. Because there's other bits and pieces of stories as well. Deus Ex Machinima runs on the Spectrum. Somebody somewhere on one of these links has a link to a copy of the whole package, which is the Spectrum program and the two audio files. I tried to use FBZX, I think, but the thing was running too fast, because the long story short on that is that the animation that you're seeing on the Spectrum screen has to match the soundtrack of the whole project itself. So I don't know, it wasn't so much something to play, although you could interact with it. It was more an art project than an actual game. When you look at Croucher's, or when I look at Croucher's philosophy, both then and now, because he's still alive and he's still on the interwebs, he pretty much, even though we are talking eccentricity, he does seem to be a man of peace and wanting computers and technology to promote peace, love, all the rest of that, instead of what it is now, which is on the argumentatively violent side with shoot 'em ups and first person violence and all the rest of that jazz. To that degree, he has caught my imagination, and I am going to get the book, I've got it ordered, of Deus Ex Machinima, which is, I'll probably give a review of it once it's arrived and I've read it. But I think it's pretty much a statement on the on the state of things and the history of gaming back then. Aconsoft were also mentioned in here as being similar, trying to buck the trend. I'll read a section of this. As in virtually every other retail industry, distributors stepped in to act as the middlemen between the publishers and the final points of sale. With far more software being produced by 1984 than they could possibly handle, these could afford to be selective. Indeed, they would say their survival depended upon it. They carefully evaluated each game sent to them to establish not only whether it was a reasonably professional, bug-free effort, but also whether it had enough mass appeal to be worthy of precious shelf space. There was an inevitable power imbalance at play. Small publishers, desperate to get their names onto shelves, in what was turning into a very uncertain year, needed distributors more than distributors needed them. Thus, the distributors could afford to drive hard bargains, demanding a 40-60% discount off retail price and a grace period of up to 2 months after delivery to pay the bill. They also wanted games to fit into one of three price points: £2 for older classics and newer discount titles, £6 for typical new games, and £10 for big prestigious releases like the Lords of Midnight or anything from the demigods over at Ultimate Play the Game. Automata bucked every one of these demands. Not only did they continue to demand high margins and cash on delivery, but they insisted that Deus Ex Machina retail at a grandiose £15. They weren't entirely alone. Others fought the New World Order and sometimes, at least temporarily, won. The most famous among them is Aconsoft, who insisted on a similarly high price point for Elite. When a number of distributors refused to carry the game, Aconsoft simply shrugged and sold to those who would, until Elite became a transformative hit and the recalcitrant distributors came back begging for Aconsoft's business. The artsy, avant-garde Deus Ex Machina, however, obviously lacked the mass appeal of an Elite. This time it was mostly the distributors who shrugged and moved on, with a predictable impact on the game's commercial fortunes. There's much more there. Croucher actually then got on with John Pertwee, and they actually wrote a book together of collective memoirs and things and tales and that. But it's the book Deus Ex Machinima. Deus Ex Machina. Why do I keep on saying Machinima? I've got Machinima the art. Yeah, it's one of those things. The paperback is Deus Ex Machina, the best game you've never played in your life. And I bought the last one, the last paperback off Amazon, so it's now usually dispatched within 5 to 8 weeks. It's titled this. The billion-dollar video game industry had to start somewhere, and this is the hilarious, heartbreaking inside story of how it all began and where it all headed. And in the middle of it all, there was a game hailed as the best ever written. It was called Deus Ex Machina. It was a creative triumph, and it was a commercial disaster. Meet the pirates, the nerds, the innovators, the charlatans, the superstars, the winners, the sinners, the good, the bad, and the downright ugly. A remarkable story revealed by the founder of the industry himself, with gut-wrenching honesty and merciless humour. If you ever wondered how computer gaming turned us all into willing slaves, you are about to find out in glorious style. I think that particular item description has been written with more than a little bit of tongue-in-cheek, but with a start like that, I couldn't really resist the book. It is available on Kindle for those who are interested. I've got various emulators. And I think the last one will be to melcroucher.net, which is his current site. He did bring back Automata UK, and he's doing various bits and pieces, video games and computers. There's all sorts of bits and pieces in here. Allergy warning, may contain nuts. Mel Croucher's name comes up rather a lot. He's rarely listed alongside the giants of game design, but talk to any of the developers and his name is like catnip. Most hail him as an inspiration. Some go further and use the word hero. That was written by Dan Whitehead, Eurogamer, in 2013, in a piece apparently entitled The Mel Croucher, the 8-bit Frank Zappa. It's a bit of an odd sight in terms of getting anything to written, anything. It's a bit bleh. You start hovering on things and things just sprout at you. But there are some comic strips in there as well. You got the Automata archive, the screenshots, the artwork, the photos. Whoa! Wow, the photos. Whoa! What is in the photos? The Golden Years, 1977 to 1985. Right. Yeah. I think Lovable Rogues is possibly... Oh, there's one. That is the Golden Sundial of Pi. Wow. Okay. So that was worth £6,000 at the time. Incredible. Right. Okay. I'll leave it for you to browse his website and the various bits and pieces that are in there, because there are a few gems of early gaming history in there. What to say, really? I think the filfree.net link, which is the first one of the second group, is probably the best to read. I think it gives the most information and paints the best picture of the history of Croucher, Automata, and what happened, and particularly to the gaming industry and how Croucher basically... tore it to shreds in the press and the rest of it. I think it's the interesting stuff at that time that I never knew, you know. I was still... yeah, by the time I'd actually grown up long enough to start playing games, all this history had long played out. But there you go. But if you're interested in that side of things... Because Croucher is possibly, quintessentially British eccentricity personified, for want of a better way of putting it. And it was sort of refreshing that the more I read about him, his views, and indeed listened to that record. Yeah. And the solution, the game itself was absolutely innovative. I mean, for an actual prize of that value to be there, to have been put up. And, you know, you could break the code as much as you liked. You would not find the answer in the code. It was up to you to take all the clues that were presented and put them together, which I, as a child of that time, would not have been able to do. The game was solved within about 2 years. And actually, it was presented not a million miles from where I'm sitting now, which was another surprise to me, because I was in South Wales at the time that I was actually playing this. But yeah, it was quite a bit of history. So I'll leave it to you to go through the links if you wish, because it will take a time to go through it all. And it's also quite a statement on what's happened and how things developed in terms of commercialization. And it's odd, but I did send a comment, well, a small missive, in fact, using the feedback form, and commented pretty much how the whole thing has come full circle. And now that we have the internet as a distribution medium, how those buyers, you know, since when did you last see games of this type on sale in shops? Gaming shops are closing down. You may find them in supermarkets, things like that. But those middlemen who once had the position of power are now pretty much out of work or have moved on to a new field. And how the internet as a medium has reinvigorated the community aspect, I think it's got a way to go yet. And I think we now have the perfect platform, not the perfect platform, but getting there, for the reemergence of the indies and the people who, you know, who fall outside the mainstream in order to nevertheless find an audience, have a fan base, and do the creative artistic stuff that sort of frees us from the from all the usual samey products, the samey games. Because that's what I think we need, a degree of originality and, oh pardon me, difference to bring in Mel Croucher, corporate and personal clients. What the heck? He's got all sorts in here. Nicholas Parsons, Latoya Jackson. Oh, he's doing web design. Ooh. Walking in Stilettos, Sands, Van Morrison. Ooh. Sharp Picture Palace Productions. BBC Shop, it looks like he's done quite a few websites over the years. Eminem, he did Eminem's website. Wow. Frank Zappa, Vidal Sassoon. Interesting. And it appears that he's living not too far away from me. He's one of those blokes that I'd love to be able to sit down with at a table over a pint and talk for an evening. Incredible. Oh well. Copyright 1948 to 2016, Mel Croucher. The guy's got a sense of humour. What can you say? Until the next video. Bye for now.